Go ahead, Elizabeth. Hi, guys, and welcome to Pacific Neuroscience Institute in Providence, Southern California's Neuroscience Grand Rounds. I'm very happy that you all are joining us and very happy to have my friend and increasingly frequent colleague here in the neurosurgical space, Dr. Randy D'Amico, joining us. We've been talking about trying to get him on for a while now and just trying to sort out what to talk about. And I think today's topic is going to be pertinent to a lot of the different neuroscience providers, not just neurosurgeons. And so here we go. Dr. D'Amico is the Assistant Professor of Neurosurgery at the Department of Neurosurgery at Lenox Hill Hospital and on faculty at Hofstra as well. Growing up in Brooklyn, it looks like he spent the entirety of his time in the New York, New Jersey area. He went did his undergraduate studies at New York University and then completed medical school at Rutgers, where he was selected to the AOA Medical Honor Society that everybody is familiar with. He did his Doris Duke Research Fellowship, a very, very competitive and prestigious fellowship at Columbia in between medical school and residency, and then stayed at Columbia to complete his neurosurgical residency, one of the top neurosurgical programs in the country. He then proceeded to do his fellowship at Lenox Hill Hospital. Many of you may be familiar with the Lenox Hill Neurosurgery Group. They've been featured on a very popular series on Netflix that I think has been re-signed for another season, and you'll probably be seeing Dr. D'Amico more on that. Throughout his training and currently, he remains a prolific neurosurgeon. He has greater than 80 peer-reviewed publications and counting. We seem to see an update from him every week. He's an active member in the AANS and the Congress of Neurological Surgeons, as well as the section on tumor, where he and I work very closely together. He's going to talk about innovations in neuromonitoring, a stimulating conversation. And with that, Randy, thank you so much for your time. And the floor is yours.
No, thank you so much, guys. I apologize. My phone keeps ringing. Someone's trying to get lab results and they're calling the wrong number incessantly. So I'm going to try to unplug this for a second. I want to extend.
We might have lost him for a bit. Let's see if he gets back here. Randy, it may be frozen there.
I'm wondering if the wrong cord got unplugged.
Oh.
I'll keep an eye on the attendees in case he comes back in so I can promote him back to the panelists.
Sounds good.
And Dr. Sivakumar, Ianthi Campos sent out emailed out a Zoom invite to all LCM users.
Gotcha. And it looks like they're coming back into this group, so we'll be fine here. His okay. talk I'm will going... still be able to finish back. He's on his way back. Apologies, everyone. We'll get back on here shortly.
Amazing speakers talking about a lot of different things. And I wanted to find an area where I think I can make some sort of an impact and teach you guys something, you know, that you probably already know, but explain kind of new ways to doing it. And so
hey, Randy, go ahead and switch the displays again real quick.
Oh, sure thing.
And switch back.
Let me see where I can do that. Let's try this. Better?
Yeah, I was also going to mention that you are one of our social media leaders, and this is perfect timing. It's still on the presenter. Go ahead and switch it back.
How about now?
If you click on that display settings, a little drop-down box comes.
Yeah, no, I just did it. It's not showing up for you guys, though?
No, it's not.
Let me see what's sharing. Maybe I'm sharing the wrong one. How about this? Better?
Yes. Yeah.
Go for it.
All right, great. Yeah, so I swear to God, we're going to get to the talk soon. But This is who I am. So I'm an assistant professor, like Wally mentioned. I direct here the Brain and Spine Metastasis Program. I'm pretty active on social media, mainly Instagram, and please feel free to follow or reach out. You know, Lenox Hill in general is pretty active about this. And we've been, I think, a little bit disruptive as a neurosurgery program with regards to some of these things. You know, as you already mentioned, we have the Netflix show, and that's where, you know, some of you might know the name Lenox Hill from. You know, ultimately, this was a sleepy little hospital on the Upper East Side that has catapulted itself, you know, into the top, you know, 25 programs in the U.S. from a neurosurgery standpoint. And that's really attributed to the two gentlemen you see here in the poster, Dave Langer and John Bookvar, who have done a phenomenal job, you know, creating a program that's pretty amazing and very forward thinking. And like you also mentioned, NYC Emergency, it's not the same show. It's a different show. It's based more on emergency cases. It follows a lot more doctors around. I am nowhere near this show. I just want you all to know that. I have a face for radio and barely for webinars. And so this is going to be primarily them again, in addition to some other fantastic and amazing doctors. So, you know, please check it out and tune in. But to dive in, especially because I've wasted a few minutes of your guys' time, neuromonitoring is incredibly important. You know, we've made so much progress in the treatment of brain cancer, and we're going to focus primarily on brain here. We'll touch a little bit on spine. Patients are doing better, especially from a metastatic disease standpoint, due to targeted therapies and immunotherapy. Obviously, there's room to grow in glioma surgery, but our microsurgical techniques have gotten a lot better. And since we're able to do safer surgery, we're able to give people better quality of life. But preservation of neurologic function, we know, is critical to that. So, you know, this story goes back to obviously the beginnings of understanding of the brain and neuroscience, where we talk about anatomy of function. And people like Brodmann looked at the brain and they mapped out important areas, the Brodmann areas, right, that were localized areas of function. But as neurosurgeons who are typically, you know, not worried so much about someone's ability to empathize with someone, it's more about the cortical spinal tract and language system, which are presented here, right? The left side, the somatosensory, you know, network, and basically the right side of the screen being your language areas, whether it's Broca's or Wernicke's, the arcuate fasciculus, things like this. We know these are canonical regions where we don't want to interfere with the brain because the deficits are severe and really life altering. And we know that when we do that, when we affect someone's functional status, we negate any progress that we would have made by resecting an entire tumor, right? That's established now in our field, or the central tenet of brain tumor surgery, right? Safe maximal resection. And so Penfield and a guy named Boldry in the 30s figured out that they can map the brain awake, right? And so they did cortical mapping on awake patients using electric currents. And this really became the gold standard over the years of how we map functional areas of the brain. We can preserve cortex this way, and it's used in brain tumor surgery, epilepsy surgery, functional neurosurgery a lot of the times. And it's really just passing electrical current through the cortex. And we've gotten a little bit better at that, right? We've got advanced imaging techniques now. So we've got tractography, which is the image here on the bottom right side of the screen, where we're able to now visualize the white matter tracts as they not only course through the brain, but around a pathology. And we have functional MRIs where we can have a patient do a task and we can see the regions of the cortex that light up. You know, the difficulties here is that, you know, for tractography, you really need to know your functional anatomy very well. You need to plant seeds typically to understand where these tracts go. And for functional MRI, the problem with that is it's not showing you the full network. It's not showing you the full, you know, parcels of land that are utilized in any function that it's showing. And so there's more to this, right? And I know you guys had Dr. Chagrou on here recently. And so we've kind of even gone further into the area of connectomics now, where we can look at these functional networks with imaging paradigms, and we can get a better sense of how we're going to approach a tumor, what areas we need to worry about within that tumor, and how to really maximize our ability to preserve function. And all of a sudden with connectomics, we're looking outside of the box of just motor strip and language. We're looking into things like the salience network, which is kind of a network involved in turning on other networks, or your central executive network, important for making, you know, human decisions, your dorsal attention network, thinking about how to exclude noise so you can focus on a task. We're getting a little bit more specific in terms of what we can measure and try to preserve. Obviously, that's newer technology. We're not going to spend a lot of time on it here, but it's fascinating. And I think it's a game changer in terms of how we plan and ultimately do surgery. But at the end of the day, there's still problems with imaging-based platforms, right? You still need to map the brain. And so I was fortunate enough to get here to Lenox and meet a guy named Justin Silverstein, who's a PhD in my neuromonitoring guru. And we work extremely closely together on all these cases. And we've tried to figure out ways to make neuromonitoring better, right? How we can trust our monitoring a little bit more, how we can perform the same kind of tasks we've all been doing, but you know, optimize it in a way that's efficient in the operating room, because these cases can take time to do, but also you know, functionally important, right? How do we make sure the patient wakes up okay? And so we kind of started this journey looking at really the short and long-term prognostic value of motor evoked potential. So looking primarily at the cortical spinal tract. And this is important because people have looked at it in brain tumors. We had a very large series. We decided to look at this specifically in brain tumor patients. And the important thing about brain tumor patients is, you know, there's progression of disease often. So in a tumor that's near an eloquent area, that disease will progress into that eloquent area. And your monitoring all of a sudden is difficult to interpret because is it disease progression or was it an injury with the surgery? And, you know, it's not always easy to figure out. And so we looked at the kind of short and long-term prognostic value by looking at people who suffered changes in monitoring, all right? So starting with motor evoked potentials, these are, you know, basically kind of some of the original neuromonitoring techniques. It was originally awake patients, like we said. It's still used today. There's the Penfield method, which uses long train stimulation at low frequency. But has problems with it. It's a high risk of causing a seizure. You have to turn the stimulation up, especially in an asleep patient, which is what we've tried to move this type of modality to. And so in the 90s, a person named Taniguchi developed an additional way to do this. And this is kind of the method that we've adopted here. And I'm curious what you guys use there. And you know, throughout the country, I kind of always ask this. What you're able to do is elicit a motor evoked potential in an anesthetized patient with instead of long train, we're using short train, very high frequency, multi-pulse stimulation. And it actually has a less risk of inducing a seizure because you're not doing this 4 to 5 second stimulation. It's kind of multi-pulse microsecond. It can be conducted continuously with your monopolar probe or your bipolar probe, really monopolar in this situation. And the stimulation is a little more superficial for cortical. And then in the 2000s, we said, well, instead of actually even touching the brain, we can do transcranials. And this is actually a little bit different. This is going through the scalp, the bone and everything. And, you know, some people do one or the other. We tend to do both. I think more is more in this situation when you want to be absolutely certain. And so we do both of these methods. So these establish a structure and functional relationship, right? There is a continuity of a white matter tract that is delivering an electrical potential. We are able to do multiple muscles in the, you know, whatever limb we're interested in. We typically do upper and lower extremity. We're using the multi-pulse stimulation to prime that anterior horn. And these are some kind of depictions of what the stimulation kind of looks like. Really just a little bit of background here. And so we looked at our 121 patients and we looked at a few different tumor types, gliomas, metastases, primarily a few meningiomas, which some people say, why meningiomas, you know? But these can be invasive and they obviously do compress motor cortex. And we looked at both transcranial, direct cortical, a few patients with awake surgery. And we were able to, basically categorize these as three different ways. So you had a stable motor evoked potential, whether it's direct cortical or transcranial, some sort of interruption. And this is a tricky area here, whether it's temporarily or completely lost, but returns, right? And that can be due to lead misplacement while you're doing surgery. That can be due to an actual injury, whether it's traction or, you know, cautery near something. But we considered this actually a false negative because the potentials returned after the initial injury. And then in a case where the potentials permanently fell below threshold and the case ended that way, we considered that a true positive. And you can see this, down below what we said was what. And so what we found here was that the transcranials, and this is, you know, established already kind of in the literature, we kind of reinforced what was there with just a larger series, that the transcranials are a little lower sensitivity, which you can expect. You need a higher amplitude basically to go through the skin and the bone and through the dura to get to the brain, but a very high specificity. If you lost your transcranials, it was a real issue in the post-operative setting. And we looked at this immediately post-operatively at discharge and then, 3 to 6 months down the road. Direct corticals have a slightly better sensitivity at 25% for immediate post-op effects, but the same specificity. But what was interesting is that both transcranial and direct corticals, the sensitivity improved at the time of discharge. And so there's this period of time where you actually have transient deficits that are not picked up by your monitoring techniques. And so what you want to say is, at the end of the case, if your monitoring is in continuity, that you can predict that someone will get better, all right? And that's really the focused question that we were trying to ask. And when we looked at the 3 to 6 month mark, it looked at, these things actually did a really good job. The specificity and for both were 100 at 3 to 6 months, and the sensitivity was difficult to assess because basically numbers game. But for the most part, all patients that had continuity at the end of the surgery returned to their baseline motor function. And so we asked, again, this is the basic gist of the question, is can they actually prognosticate? And the answer is yes. And so the sensitivity improves the farther away you are from surgery. And again, in the absence of tumor progression, we took out cases where there was clear tumor progression and notable weakness here. And so again, the goal here was to show exactly what we say at the bottom, which is that the motor evoked potentials are intact, the chance of a true structural damage is extremely low. And so this is the kind of the basis of how we started kind of all the work we're going to do. We said, all right, I believe monitoring, right? And especially in this tumor population. And so then you start asking yourself, well, we have really good asleep motor evoked potentials now. We know we can trust it. So when do we need to do awake surgery, right? And awake surgery, and I think classically has been for language mapping. But there are still times where I would consider it for motor mapping. And that's for someone who really uses their fine motor skills as a work or a passion that's really important to them. Remember, quality of life is kind of first and foremost. But for the most part at this point, because of the trust I have in my asleep motor mapping, I've really reserved this for language mapping, which remains kind of, unable to be monitored asleep. And we've tried it actually. But the problem is here is that everyone can't be awake during surgery, right? There are contraindications. Altered mental status, confusion, this is a situation where it's not going to be helpful to be awake. If a patient's, agitated and can't participate, obviously another reason. Age, I don't deal with pediatrics anymore, but in theory, obviously, young children can't be awake. In training, we limited it to like 8 to 10 years old for the most part. And even that was a struggle. Language barriers are becoming less of an issue, especially with translation services and the iPads, but it still can be an issue, especially with a rare, a rarer language. And so we looked back at the data or the literature that's already been published, and we found, these studies by Deletis, who described kind of the motor homuncular region and how it was associated with really laryngeal muscles of phonation and kind of the muscles of speech for the most part. And he looked at this and he stimulated with either TMS or direct cortical stimulation. And he was able to identify regions of speech arrest. And, for the most part, he was able to establish that not just primary motor for speech, but also Broca's area, meaning the inferior frontal gyrus or the pars opercularis, are all important for encoding that word, being able to produce that language as it sends commands basically to the M1 or the primary motor strip. And so we decided let's cover our oral facial coverage or our muscles. And so we use the ET tube for vocalis muscle monitoring. We monitor cricothyroid, oris and mentalis, and the tongue for asleep motor speech. And we said, well, can we do this in cases that are primarily putting Broca's area or M1 at risk? This is obviously not touching Wernicke's area. This is not higher level speech function. And it's really important to understand that, because this is not a fix-all for asleep language mapping. This is really specific cases involving the frontal operculum or M1 when you're doing kind of a sleep motor. You can also do a sleep motor speech to a degree. And so this is kind of what's really important to this, which is actually, here. We use a 1x6 strip electrode. We do phase reversal and we make sure we're on M1. And then we can stimulate with direct cortical stimulation through that 1x6. And then we can use a monopolar in the pars opercularis area. And what we find are these short latency responses and these long latency responses. And the short latency responses are M1. This is primary motor. It's a fast conduction through the motor strip into, you can see here, vocalis. And then the long latency responses are the ones that are coming from the pars opercularis. It's kind of the decision to move your mouth for the most part, I guess, is one way to think about it, from Broca's area. And so we can actually map these. And so we looked at it in seven patients, asleep, motor speech mapping. We did our transcranials, our direct corticals, and obviously the muscles of phonation for the most part. And what we found was that we were able to identify the orofacial area and that it actually works. When you're actually awake and monitoring, you can find these responses and preserve it. And so, basically it's a surrogate for awake craniotomy, specifically in these patients that cannot tolerate it, when we're not worried about a receptive aphasia. And that's kind of the most important part. And, you know, we're obviously compiling data on this now and looking at it, but it's interesting. And it's really, to be honest with you, it's a really great option, because there are times, and probably more often than not, where you need this. The other area where we've gotten, fairly innovative, although it's been described before, we're just kind of modified it, and is in the area of dynamic subcortical stimulation. And this can actually be brought into our awake motor speech mapping as well. And so the idea here is kind of rooted in subcortical stimulation, which was really kind of pioneered by Defoe in the early 2000s. And basically he did it with the Penfield method. So that Ogerman stimulator, the bipolar stimulator, once you get under the cortex or in the white matter, and you basically stimulate, you identify a response or not, and then you resect. And you can do that, piecemeal basically throughout a case, but it can be time consuming and discontinuous as you're pulling instruments in and out and switching. Since the Taniguchi method has kind of been adopted, you can actually do this now instead of a bipolar stimulation, you can use cathodal monopolar stimulation. And this is kind of what I alluded to earlier on. And instead of this kind of tight ellipse, you can actually get a general more kind of spreading radially electric field that becomes a little more sensitive than the traditional bipolar method. There's less likelihood of eliciting a false negative. This kind of mitigates the risk of an inadvertent irreversible motor injury, because you're spreading widely, you're getting closer, and you're able to pick up earlier what's going on. You can see in the cartoons, what this actually looks like in an operation. You map out the cortex that you're going to enter, you enter the tumor, and then just piecemeal by piecemeal, as you get closer, you start eliciting stimulation when you get closer, and you can stop your resection in time before you cause the permanent injury. And so the current kind of way we think about this is that about 1 milliamp is 1 millimeter. And this has never been really validated. But when you look at your post-op films, it actually holds fairly true. And what we wanted to do was be able to do this in a dynamic fashion. Rather than pulling instruments in and out of the field, can we design an instrument that can do this continuously while we operate, so that the closer we get, we start getting alerts while you're operating. It's more efficient in the operating room. So, we're using this 0.5 to 0.7 hertz cathodal pulses. You can use the same monopolar you would use on the cortex. So on the cortex, you would use anodal pulses, but when you go subcortical, you have to make sure you switch it. And, most literature suggests that you stop at 5 milliamps, so about 5 millimeters from the capsule. Although in certain situations, you can go lower. I've been as low as, 3 milliamps in things like meningiomas, where there's a capsule, or metastatic disease often. And so why do this? So, we kind of already said the static is more time consuming. You can't really do it in real time. You have to kind of remember where you were, mark it, go back in. And then there's this whole, issue of bringing instruments repeatedly in and out of the field. And then, you have your bipolar in there and you take a little bit more than extra and you cause a problem. So we wanted to kind of fix that problem. So what we did is we took this idea that was first kind of described by Rob, which is an insulated suction device. And he's produced this commercially. And we wanted to just make our own that was cheaper. We didn't see any reason to pay. I think his costs like $80 or $90 per suction. And the problem with it is that it's actually a fixed diameter Fraser suction. And I don't know, Wally, how you operate, but I like a variable. I like a Fukushima suction where I can vary my suction pressure. And I use a big suction. I use a 9 French or sometimes even more, sometimes a 10 French on a big tumor just to move through it quickly.
Same.
And so this allows you to really kind of modify any suction you want. And you can all of a sudden create your own dynamic subcortical stimulator with just, you know, things that you have around the operating room. And so again, this is kind of what we mentioned, 7 Frenches of Rob suction. They're not in every hospital. I think you have to specifically order them. And so this is what we've done. We took a common red rubber catheter, which most hospitals have, and we used it to insulate my standard Fukushima suction. And then we got a sterile alligator clip that connects to the stimulating box, basically. And we electrify the suction. We apply the alligator clip where you see the arrow there. And this allows you now to take any suction that you would preferentially use in a surgery, and you can stimulate through it. And it functions the same as any monopolar stimulator. And so I use a 9 French most commonly. So an 18 French rubber suction is what I would use. We've actually toyed with a lot of different materials. You could use steri strips on here to insulate. You could use Tegaderm. They all seem to work. We haven't done the full studies yet in terms of optimization for this. But again, you can make this in your operating room. The scrub tech's making it about 5 minutes. I hate the Tegaderm because then the scrub tech has to take it off and I feel really bad about it. The rubber suction comes off easy. But as you can see, there's a little bit of a broadening of your visual window. So when you're operating on a skull top lesion, something on the cortex, it's easy. It doesn't matter so much if it's in the way. When you're doing real microsurgery and you're somewhere deep, you may want to use a smaller suction or consider that Tegaderm. And so this is kind of what it looks like in action. You see the alligator clip. There's a little, about 5 millimeters or 3 millimeters or so of exposed suction at the bottom that's not insulated. And these are the settings that we use in case anyone wants to replicate this. So you train a 500 microsecond pulse width. I already talked about the repetition rate. We place an anodal return on the contralateral skull base. So if you're operating on the left, obviously the right side skull base. And we start our stimulation around 15 milliamps, sometimes 20, depending. And this is important, all right? Because you're gonna do your direct cortical mapping first at whatever you normally do it and find your thresholds. And then when you get into the subcortical regions and you're at the tumor margins, you really wanna start at something 15 to 20, because you wanna make sure you're about 1.5 to 2 centimeters away from that margin. And then as you operate, you're gonna elicit potentials like you see here in the bottom right. And you're gonna pause. And the difference here between a dynamic, as you're saying, oh, well, you stopped the surgery, is that it's the same tools that you have right there in the op. It's the same tool you're gonna use to resect that piece of tissue. And you pause and you lower that threshold. So if I get a stimulation at 15, I'm gonna stop right there with my suction on that tissue and I'm gonna come down to 10. And typically my neurophysiologist will tell me, he'll say, you know, stimulation went away at 12 milliamps. And then we're going to take a little bit more tissue and we're going to really dissect that rind down until we get to that, you know, 5 milliamp mark. And then we're going to, you know, believe in monitoring, right? Because that's what we do. We believe in monitoring. And so you can see again, as low as 3 milliamps, really in Mets and meningiomas primarily. The reason I showed up just on time is we were just upstairs and we had someone down to 4 milliamps on a Met. I trust this implicitly, to be honest with you. I've had really great experiences doing this. It's changed how I operate in these motor strip lesions or anything even near the motor strip. I'm very frequently using this. And so I think I have a video. Let me know if this plays. There's no sound, but the first thing you're going to see, there is some sound. So that's a direct. So. So I don't know if there was sound on that or not, but basically, what's that?
No sound.
All right. So basically what we did, I apologize, is we have a direct cortical strip down. And in each of those areas, we mapped cortically with the same suction device that I'm going to use subcortically. And we found forearm and hand regions along the back wall there, just in front of the strip. And so then, you know, what you don't see here is we mark those off and we enter the tumor from the anterior margin, basically. And then we dissect backwards towards the motor strip there. And so let me see here. So this is what the monitoring looks like here. And again, I don't think you guys have sound, but this is the subcortical motor evoked potentials as we kind of go through. And you'll see kind of very small potentials there in the left hand as we get it. And they're small. And this is why the importance of having a good neuromonitoring person, you know, with you, who understands kind of what you're doing, it makes the job infinitely easier. So we'll go through to the next one. So again, here's subcortical showing facial stimulation here and the crico. So we're doing this now for what I mentioned before, the asleep speech. We're able to stimulate these things subcortically, and dynamically in real time. And I think this is another video, and it's going to show you that this is the operation here on the right side. And you can see I'm pausing in a region that they're getting stimulation in the hand here at the anterior margin. And you can see we're dropping the milliamps from 15 to 11.5 and it goes away. And so we can resect a little bit more at that margin if we need to. And then here on the top, we're seeing all of a sudden there's stimulation here at 10 milliamps. And you're going to see, I think we drop it down to 7 and it goes away. So we're about 7 millimeters presumably, and I can hug that margin carefully there. And so I don't know about you guys, Wally, but you know, me and my monitoring guy are just shouting at each other the entire case. I'm telling him where he is, where I am. He's telling me what potential he's at. And it's a really, a really open forum for communication so that we can make sure that we're not gonna do anything that, that's gonna damage the patient for the most part.
Yeah, that's how we do it too. He's actually on this talk because I've been talking to him about doing this. At our place as well. So I'm going to be copying you here shortly.
Oh, absolutely. We'll talk and we can live stream it maybe or something too. Awesome. All right, let's move through. So anyway, so we published this, sorry guys, we got a million phone calls today. And really a technical note, we have a series of, I think 20 patients or so that just got accepted to JNO. So that should be out soon. And you know, our results, you know, I think it's proof of principle right now. We have to obviously go forward and see, how to study this in a way that proves that it's better or not. And there's different ways to do that, right? Operative time, deficits, and things like that. But the most important thing is that it works. And it makes me very comfortable while I'm operating that I'm not going to go, traipsing into a really, functional area and cause permanent injury. So the last thing I wanted to talk about, and it changes the game a little bit from cranial work is to spinal cord tumor. So I do spine oncology here in addition to brain work. And one thing that, it changed the game from the way I practice to now is we no longer are using just motor evoked potentials and SSEPs, right? We've started using D-waves in the setting of intramedullary tumors. And so my neuromonitoring guru and I have discussed this at length. And can we change D waves to make them a little bit better? We all know that there's a high signal to noise ratio when you're doing this. And sorry, for those who don't know, D waves allow us to monitor cortical spinal tract continuity, basically, when you're doing an intramedullary spinal cord tumor. And so we had the idea of, let's put these in the subdural space. Traditionally, they're placed epidurally. And there's this high noise that's associated with it, and it makes it somewhat difficult sometimes to interpret. And so we stimulate the motor cortex with the scalp, we record this descending action potential, and basically we wanted to, do a trial where we're placing these in the subdural space, which has classically been argued against just because of tumor swelling, the tight space, there's arachnoid if you cause a bleed. But it's actually, if your durotomy is wide enough and you're really at the front and back of the tumor or the rostral and caudal end of it, these electrodes can fit in pretty well. And there's less exposure to air. There's less exposure to bony elements. There's a component of CSF there, maybe even compression against the dura. And basically what we've done is compare the epidural to the subdural D-wave recordings. We've been prospectively collecting this. Obviously, these are rare lesions. We don't have a lot of them. We excluded anything below the level of T9, just because D-wave don't really work below there. And this is kind of where we're at right now. So we've got about 5 surgeries so far. We've got epidural D-waves in about 80%, and we've got subdurals in 100%. So right off the bat, you know, small number, but it's very consistent. The epidurals were unreliable just due to noise, poor electrode impedances causing recordings to be unmonitorable. Whereas when we place them subdural, we have significantly less noise, and we find them to be very reliable here. And you can see the picture difference here. I think it speaks for itself. And so you can see here, here's a caudal epidural with, you know, no D wave captured versus our subdural D wave capturing here. And so this is something we're obviously, you know, collecting patients for now, in addition to be able to do this on a larger basis and get a better sense. But it just basically, it comes down to connectivity, right? The subdural electrode is able to better stimulate the spinal cord. You get better impedance, less artifact, and a better signal to noise ratio. And so we'll keep you posted on that. And so that's kind of my update on what we've done here. Again, I think, you know, I can't do this without Justin Silverstein is my neuromonitoring guy. And, you know, basically he's like Willy Wonka, where I come to him with a dream or an idea and he makes it happen. So he's been incredible to work with. And I would anticipate a lot more stuff coming out from here about this. We've got a great database and we've got a lot of ideas. And so I'm happy to take any questions about this. And I appreciate your guys' time and attention. Sorry about the hiccups in the beginning.
No, Randy, that was fantastic. And I think actually the timing is perfect because it'll allow us to answer questions and things like that. I'm actually going to bring up my neuromonitoring lead, Zaid, onto the talk as well. He can maybe ask a couple of the questions that he's put up. I've been waiting for you to do this talk, and I think it's a perfect complement to our discussion on the connectomics a year and a half or so ago. So I think it gives people a much better and expanded understanding of what we're talking about here.
Yeah, I wish we could monitor some of the other networks, you know, we're working on it.
Well, I think that's when it's gonna actually be useful, right? A lot of, you know, we are working with that connectomics team at Santa Monica and here with Garney and Dan and myself. And the issues are, it's just at a certain point, it's like basically you can't touch anything. And so the utility of it, I mean, that's what's holding us back, right?
Yeah. Who knew that the brain was important?
I'm telling you. I thought somebody said it's only 5%.
Yeah. It's
everything. But, you know, what you're doing right now and a lot of these updates are going to make that data infinitely more usable. And I think my favorite part of your discussion, especially when it comes to the bipolar, I mean, the stimulating suction, is we're talking about OR efficiency here. As you know, and I think everybody in the audience has a sense of this, the number of expected surgical cases that are going to need to be done in the community as we get into baby boomers reaching that age are going to grow here dramatically.
Yeah.
And the hospitals are already strained as they are because of all the challenges. We're going to need to be able to do surgery more efficiently with lower complications. And the work that I've talked about here with our enhanced recovery work, we need to get patients in and out of the hospital sooner and faster and better and safer.
Absolutely.
And decrease costs. So stuff like you're talking about, you know, I will say you need to get your device out there, you know, and figure out a way with our keyhole surgery. That's my only thing I'm trying to figure out here. How do I get it into these smaller spaces?
Yeah. And so I think the tricky part there is the insulation, right?
Absolutely.
Which again, we made this because we said basically now every institution in the country can have a dynamic subcortical stimulator, right? All you need is a neuromonitoring guy who knows what he's doing, or girl. And then you need an insulated suction, which you can make. It costs probably $1 to make that,
absolutely,
right? Versus an $80 prefab that you're uncomfortable using anyway, because it's not what you normally would use. And so, and this is modifiable. So if I'm at the skull base, and you can do this, I didn't talk about it, but you can do this to monitor cranial nerves. if I'm doing an acoustic neuroma,
that makes sense.
I can monitor my suction. And so as I'm operating and dissecting, now, you know, again, I use a cartouche for a lot of dissection anyway, but now you've got two modalities here. You can switch to the suction. You're going to be in there. So when you're in the tighter space, all of a sudden you're using a 6 French suction instead of a 9 French suction. You can do the same exact thing. And it works, you know, it's pretty straightforward.
And I think that's where, you know, for a lot of the non-surgeons in the audience, we have quite a few of them. This idea about OR efficiency is a huge point of focus right now. And especially when you're down at the skull base working between nerves, you can't just stick in instruments, you know, here and there. Each one of those moves takes a couple of extra seconds as you're bringing things through. So if you stop the number of instruments that get changed, you know, over the course of like an acoustic, that's 6 or 8 hours, you're talking about considerable time, but also decreased risk of injury because you're having to traverse the nerves, you know.
Yeah, you're moving instruments in and out.
I think this is going to be huge, man. I really do.
Yeah, and I think...
Oh, go ahead.
Yeah, I was just going to say for the non-surgeons, I think the important thing here is that, you know, we're not cowboys. You know, my outcomes at this stage in my career are the single most important thing to me. It's my currency, right? It's how I get more patients with good outcomes. So if I go in and I'm making people hemiparetic or losing arm function and stuff like that, I'm hurting myself. I'm hurting my career. I'm hurting, you know, human beings first and foremost. And so we can do this safely. And, you know, I would rather leave tumor behind and make sure someone can, you know, hug their family member or feed themselves any day of the week, you know? So this allows you to be just absolutely safe.
Absolutely. Dr. Braganthi asks, hi, with the neuromapping, can you notice, interesting question. With the neuromapping, can you see any effects that may suggest that they've taken any mind-altering medications or cannabis? I know it's a broad question, but are you able to sense that?
You know, the bigger issue, no, not really, because it's all just, it's electrophysiology, right? At the end of the day, it's continuity and it's conduction for the most part. I will say that people who use cannabis preoperatively or routinely, I think, tend to have higher anesthesia requirements. And so, you know, a good anesthesiologist who is comfortable doing mapping is absolutely important. And so, you know, if you don't have full twitches, you're gonna miss something. And so it really involves a conversation with your anesthesiologist. You need to have a good baseline understanding of what you're gonna do with this case and what you need to perform good monitoring.
You know, as part of the enhanced recovery stuff that we were talking about, we've essentially moved all surgeries in most spine as well into, you know, full TEVA, which seems to make things a lot better. What's your process there?
Yeah, no, we're basically the same, especially because I do a lot of monitoring and mapping stuff. I think, you know, our ERAS is focused less so on that. I think we still have gas issues on some cases, but for brain, for me, I don't have a problem. I do the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Good. For everybody else, when we're talking about total intravenous anesthesia, we're talking about the use of intravenous agents versus gas anesthetics. And there's some data out there that shows that that has decreased nausea and vomiting, easier immersion from surgery, and fewer effects on your neuromonitoring. As Dr. D'Amico mentioned here, you know, any kind of changes, he didn't really talk about it. We talked about it in other sessions. When you have these changes, it doesn't automatically mean that there's injury to the brain, and oftentimes it doesn't. Yeah. And that's one of the big challenges here that, you know, pioneers like Dr. D'Amico are really helping to fix, when we can actually trust the data that we're getting.
Yeah, you're right. I didn't comment on it. And that's just because I think I forget about it. I've got such a good system where it's less of an issue. I run into these problems more with spine, I would say, with the spine oncology, where if you lose a motor evoked potential, what's your protocol? All right. Is it making sure the patient's temperature is up, checking your lead, making sure blood pressure is good, you know, making sure the contact of your leads is in the right place. Every hospital has a protocol for this. And so, the majority of my talk is excluding that. It is, you believe your monitoring is perfect. So how do you use it?
And a big part of that is being able to trust your neuromonitoring team. And, you know, with that, I wanted to let Zaid here ask his question, if he would. You can just
Hi, Dr. Wally. Thank you, Dr. D'Amico. pretty eye-opening and definitely something that one could consider applying in our day-to-day practice. Particularly fond of the protocol. I'm thinking of sitting with Dr. Wally and probably drafting something in terms of what's our preferred protocol and if we lose a signal. And that will make practice much easier if it's not me in the room.
Absolutely. Make
communication more thorough, more streamlined. Now, I have a couple of questions in regards to subcortical mapping. Question number one is, have you had any issues with noise when you're constantly using the suction tube as a stimulator? And question number two is, knowing that a lot of our IV medications are anti-seizure medications, the fact that the risk of seizure during tumor resection have decreased significantly, the constant stimulation of the brain using the methods you've mentioned and using direct cortical MEPs as well, does that increase the risk of seizures during surgery, or have you haven't noticed any of that?
So I would say that we've had probably two seizures in the past probably 2 years. And a lot of it, when I talk to my monitoring guy about this, you know, we talk about it as the Taniguchi method being the changer here. That methodology is just less risk of seizure. Now, I've had a seizure in an awake craniotomy using an Ojiman stimulator, not my monopolar. And I've had a seizure with another surgeon who's not well versed necessarily in this, who turned the stimulation up way high for a direct cortical stimulation. And so it's really a, you know, what you're comfortable with. I think that the Taniguchi method does eliminate this risk to a degree. We don't have noise issues at all. I think that the recordings, I mean, I showed you a few. I don't know if you were following along. I can show you again. They're fairly clean. We run into the same problems as everyone else where, you know, the bear hugger is causing, you know, some 60 hertz in the system and whatnot. But for the most part, it's very, very clean. And actually, I'd love to, why don't we set an email afterwards and I'll introduce you to Justin Silverstein. He would be more than happy to get on the phone with you and talk about this.
I'd love to. Thank you so much.
That'd be great. We, Dr. Kelly was using the Ojiman stimulator. I think Garney and I switched over some time ago, but it sounds like Zaid was texting me during, he's recently switched over to the Taniguchi as well.
Yeah, to the monopolar.
Yeah. I mean, knock on wood, I haven't had a seizure.
Let me tell you, one with the Ojiman, the way I use it now is still awake surgery. So we've tried a monopolar for a sleep speech mapping and for Wernicke's mapping, you know, with an awake patient using a monopolar, because if you can do that, then you could, in theory, do dynamic subcortical stim the same way we're doing it in the motor strip. And it does not work. I don't know why. I don't know if it has to do with the specificity of the stimulation or just you need that longer train. You need that 4 to 5 second pulse. We've never been able to make it work. But what I've done is I've actually just taken the Ojiman and I just use it as a dynamic retractor now. And so I put it at a constant 5 milliamps. I shove it against where I think language is and I resect until I get stimulation at 5. And then I just take it out. I use it as a retractor almost. I kind of guide my surgery with it. And so I'm doing the same technique, obviously a little bit more risk of a seizure. And just from manipulation of the brain alone, you can run into paraphasic errors or speech arrest. You know, you have to be gentle with it. But I've kind of tried, you know, I've moved forward and then moved back again with that. Mm-hmm. And so in awake surgery in particular for language mapping, I'll use that.
I really look forward to the day where we never have to do another awake.
I know, right?
It sounds, you know, sexy to talk about, but the logistical issues are, I'm not a fan.
Yeah.
Let me see here if there's any additional questions here. I think Dr. Rao is asking, are there any other questions that are coming up here? Randy, I really wanted to thank you here for joining us today. I think this is amazing. And getting an idea of where we are right now and with the expansion of the Connectomics, you know, project around, I think this is going to be, the talk in 2 years is going to be so different. You know, you talked about tumor biology not changing over time. I think this is sort of the opposite of that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And we're doing a lot of work on this. So like I said, stay tuned. Neuromonitoring, I think, is, you know, as safe brain surgery becomes the most important for the reasons you've already mentioned, getting people in and out of the hospital, getting their diagnosis, letting medical management treat brain tumors, because ultimately it's not a surgical disease, right? We're there to save a life from someone whose life is threatened by their tumor. We're there to get a diagnosis. We're there to hopefully affect the greatest change that they're going to, you know, the only modifiable risk factor, right? But getting that patient out of the hospital relies on them being safe, and we're going to get better at this and figure out new ways to do it better. And, you know, that's all happening now. So it's an exciting time.
Love it. Love it. Love it. Thanks, man.
All right. Thank you guys. I appreciate the time.
What we will do, we will let Dr. D'Amico get on with his day. I want to thank everybody for joining us today. And as always, you know, whenever you want to come back, Randy, let me know. I'd love to get an update on this. You know,
absolutely, man. And we'll talk offline. And Zaid, feel free to reach out.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and I'll arrange that for sure. If there are any, we will see you again in the second Tuesday in April coming up, and we'll send out the invitations for that. And if anyone has any requests or suggestions of talks they would like to see, please don't hesitate to reach out. With that, everybody have a healthy and safe rest of their March time, and we will see you all in April. Take care,
everyone. Take care.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you, everybody.